titles. She is a speaker, a best-selling author, the founder of Get Your Life Back Life Coaching, the Goddaughters Workshop and His Garden Naturals. She is a mother, minister, and entrepreneur, and she is here to talk to us today about finding your why and connecting your passion with your purpose. Ladies, please welcome Cheryl Howard.
So glad to see all your wonderful faces. I just love it when you women can get together and empower one another. Amen.
Amen.
So I'm going to share like three little quick stories of how I found my passion and my purpose. I just have a passion because a lot of times I hear a lot of people say, I don't know what my purpose is. I don't know what my passion is in life, or they can't identify it. And sometimes it's little simple things that we can do to kind of find out what it is that we love to do. And another truth is sometimes our purpose and passion change in life when we go through different stages, different transitions in life. You know, you may start out doing one thing, but then maybe in this season, maybe it's time for you to do something else. So you don't have to be married to one purpose or one passion, because a lot of us are multitasking, multifaceted, and we have multi-purpose. Would we agree with that?
Yes.
So I'm going to start from when young, because we all, usually most of us have the existential question of, why am I here? You know, then you find yourself in another season, what do I do next? And then there's another season that says, what do I do now? Like I said, because we go through transitions, and sometimes when we go through these transitions, it could be because of loss, displacement, abandonment. We find ourselves like in situations like divorce, like I have, and you'd want to know, you know, what do I do now? Because that part of your life, especially as a wife, your husband was like part of the center of your life, but now you don't have that husband. It's like, what do I do now? Because I was attached to being a wife, and now it's almost sometimes we have to take the journey of finding ourselves again. But I want to start from when I was little, and I went through something that I call the misfit syndrome. Now, I know a lot of you are younger in here, but some of you remember the Christmas animated shows. There was an animated show with the Santa Claus show, and there was a place called the Land of Misfit Toys. Anybody remember that?
Yes.
So it's so funny. I connected myself with a young girl who found instead of getting a Jack in the Box, she ended up with a Charlie in the Box. I don't know, for some reason, it made me cry when I was a little girl, and I think because the toy was like deformed. It was like, these are misfit toys that nobody wanted. But the little girl loved that Charlie in the Box. And I said, I guess it resonated with me because I felt like that growing up, like the misfit, didn't fit in with the crowds. I felt like the Charlie in the Box. And so I was able to relate to that. It was just so, you know, you find out sometime when you get older that, wow, I was kind of traumatized, but I didn't know at the time. But so I went through that stage of trying to find out who I am, where I fit in. I grew up in the projects, and my temperament was usually different than everybody else around me. I wasn't a hardcore girl. I wasn't a girl running around robbing and beating people. I never really learned how to physically fight when I was young, but a lot of girls around me were really tough, you know, and they did all that stuff. So in that kind of environment, I never felt like I belong in that type of environment. So you can imagine the stuff that I went through with the young girls I grew up with, always wanted to fight me for no reason. I remember one particular time I was coming from church, minding my business, I don't bother anybody, and I remember a bunch of girls standing outside saying, oh wow, she thinks she cute. And I'm like, how do I think I'm cute? Because I'm coming from church, I'm not saying that to anybody. But you know, a lot of us when we're young, we have insecurities, low self-esteem, and I understand now that that's what that was coming from. But when you're young, you don't really know that. And so, you know, it comes out sometimes aggressive. Me, I internalize a lot of stuff. They was more aggressive with their trauma. And what I tell a lot of people today, I say, you know what, just because a person shows a lot of aggression or they're vulgar, they're loud, it doesn't mean they're stronger. It just means you hit a sensitive area. Maybe you are different where you internalize things and you go in a quiet corner. Both are still sensitive because guess what, it affected you. Whatever that person says still affected you. So strength is not really in your aggression, it's in how you cope and deal with stuff in life. And so I went through that period of being a misfit person. So one thing that's good about that, through that transition, that period of time, I was able to identify that I had a love for doing hair, you know, making people look good. And so I found my creativity. And for me, it was a distraction because, like I said, I didn't fit in with everybody else. So I found, and you know, started with my doll babies. I had my little dolls, and I noticed I would place them on a lot. And so I found something to kind of get my attention away from the things I was kind of going through. So then I became the hairstylist in the hood, if you will. So I started doing people's hair for free at first, until the older women would get on me and say, girl, you better start charging around here making this money. Because I was doing hair, some of you probably don't know about these places. I'm from New York. Place called Billie Jean's and all these other places. They was like top places that did weave and braids. And I was doing hair just as good as them. So I started charging, making my little money. Now I'm taking you on a journey because, of course, running up in the projects, for me, I didn't hear about the word entrepreneurship. I can look back now and say I had the spirit of entrepreneurship. But if you don't have that type of nurturing or somebody to kind of cultivate your childhood and pull out, that's another strategy, pulling out things that maybe you went away from because of transitions in your life, but sometimes you tap back in to those childhood dreams and passions and visions that you have. And I did that, especially after I went through my divorce. I'm going to get to that in a minute. So I went through all, I got my little PowerPoint thing here. I went through all of that. Then, you know, love and marriage came. So I met my husband. We got married. I moved out of the projects. He was an avionics engineer, so I made it out the projects, but had a dream and a vision, and he supported me in that as well. So, of course, I started working at a salon. Now, I got to say, I went to beauty school, but then I dropped out of beauty school the first time. So I became the beauty school dropout. But then I eventually went back to cosmetology school. Guess what? That was my love. You know, my husband, I didn't have a high school diploma. But my husband did. You know, he had degrees and went to aviation high school and Air Force Academy. And so I'm the girl from the projects who didn't have a diploma, but I still had a love to do hair. So that was the passion I, you know, went towards. I went to school, I got my licensing, and then I started working and doing hair, whatever. That happened. So the next transition was my divorce. So that question comes, well, what do I do next? Again, because part of my identity was being a wife. And I became a mother, my beautiful daughter, who's 24 years old now. I became a mother, and so it's just her and I. But because I didn't make a lot of money, I went through homelessness. First, I had a place of my own, but I could no longer afford it for myself. So we've struggled for a couple of years. You know, God was good. And you know, I had friends who allowed us to stay on a couch. I met a woman who was a pastor. I mean, it's funny, even when you're going through stuff and you have a call, you have a purpose, I believe that God has a way of lining you up with the people you need to be with during that season. Mm-hmm. And I met this wonderful woman who had transitional homes, women and men's shelters. And I was working in a salon in a mall, and she has a gift of prophecy. So she looked at me way across the salon and said, you're going to be on TV. I don't know who you are. You're going to be a speaker. You're going to be this. She just started really speaking over my life. And I said, wow. She said, I have a transitional housing. You and your daughter can stay there. You can imagine I'm sitting in the salon crying and bawling. I'm like, oh, my God. I didn't say nothing to this woman. Okay, so we stayed there for a while. And in the midst of that, I understood that I needed to make some changes. So I went to school. And one of my other passions is I love to counsel. I love to talk with people. I like to empower people. It pains me when I hear people say, I don't know what my purpose is. I don't know what my passion is. I don't know what I desire to do. And one of the things I tell people, ask people around you what they see in you. Because sometimes, you know, we don't do that. Ask your villagers. Ask your friends. Ask your family members. Ask your coworkers. What do you see in me? What comes out of my spirit every time I talk? For me, it's preaching or it's speaking. I just can't help it everywhere I go. And I started doing that. People start telling me that. And one of my friends would say to me, Cheryl, you are so good at counseling. You are so good at making people feel great. She said, it doesn't matter what comes out your mouth. It could be about nothing. But you have a way of conveying a message that makes people buy into it, like me. She said, like her. I was like, okay. So that led me into going to school to become a social worker and a mental health counselor. And so that's what I did when I went to school. I got my GED, finally. But getting that, I'm telling you, sometimes when you go through stuff, and I don't ever, try not to get discouraged. Be around a body of people who keep you encouraged. And the reason why I say that is because I remember when I was going back to school to get my GED, and it was time to take the test. And I have a couple of situations like this. I call it earthquake season, when everything is like crazy going on at one time. And I had took one part of the GED exam. And I was so great because my biggest fear was the math, because I was never illiterate in school. I just dropped out in 10th grade because of different circumstances. So I knew how to read and everything, but my biggest fear was like, oh my God, I don't even know if I'm going to pass the math test. But I passed the math part of the exam. The second part of the test was taken on another day. I went to go take that test. I got there a little too late. There was two guards sitting there. It was a female guard and it was a male guard. They said they had not started the test yet. She can go take it. So them two arguing, and the woman security guard was like, no, she can't go, it was late. They wouldn't let me in. So for a moment, it felt like every time I try to do something, something else comes in the way, like a jagger gets thrown. And so I walked down this street called Jamaica Avenue in Queens, just tears rolling down my eyes. That spirit of the misfit was coming back again. Like, wow, I'm trying to do something, and here comes something else. So I was crying and crying, I couldn't even see walking down the street, just tears rolling down my eyes, and I'm praying. But I end up getting into a school that gave me the skills I needed, computer skills and GED classes, and I ended up going to a college, because God made a way for that too, where I didn't have to take the exam. I went to a college where if you earn your credits, 30, 20-something credits, you will earn your diploma. So I was like, thank you, that came at the right timing. So I was able to do that, finish school. I finally, just to speed things up, I have my master's in human services and counseling. I did 2 years of graduate clinical master's in social work at Fordham University. And then I went to Liberty University online and got a master's in human service and theological studies. But going through all of that, I still had those disempowering thoughts. Sometimes you get those self-defeated thoughts that say, I remember one particular day going to school and hearing a voice saying, I don't know why you're going back to school. I don't even know why you're going through the motions. You're never going to finish. You're not going to graduate. You're never going to get your degree. So I had to learn to delete those negative disempowering thoughts and replace them with positive thoughts, positive self-affirmation, and tell myself I can. And by that point, because I had such a good community, friends, church members, I was able to do that. And then people spoke into me and saw things in me, like, you're so great at this. So I leaned on all of that stuff, and I started dismantling all of the negative thoughts and the feelings and the disbeliefs and those core beliefs that a lot of us have. We don't even recognize it. That little voice that tells you you're not good or make you feel like you have an imposter syndrome, like you're going to be found out. They're going to find out you really ain't nothing. You know, all of those thoughts. And I know I'm not the only one who experienced having those thoughts. I think most of us have those thoughts. But we come to a place in life where we're able to supersede those thoughts with the positive affirmations. And acknowledging your strengths. That's another strategy. Acknowledge the strength that you have. You know, maybe you're good at deliberating. Maybe you're a good peacemaker where you can come into an atmosphere and create peace. That can be attached to your purpose. One of the things I said, like, because I like the counseling, I like the speaking, and I did preaching, was I like to empower people. Like this here, for instance, coming to a conference like this and empowering other women, because sometimes we'll look around the room and we think people got it together because we look really good. We look beautiful in here. But you don't know what people are going through. You don't know what trauma people are experiencing right now. I have been in many rooms while I was homeless. Nobody knew it because, you know, I look great. You don't have, you know, I'm not one to walk around with a heart on my sleeve. You know, that's not me anyway. I don't walk around like, woe is me, oh God, this happened to me again. Like I said, I internalize it, but I've learned to give those things and you know, pray on those things. But you never know who's going through something. So get rid of that mindset or that little voice that says, you're an imposter, you're not as good as that. When you know women, we can easily go into comparing each other to one another. You know, we have, sometimes we deal with those little things, but when you find out that you are wonderfully, fearfully made, you are unique, you have your own strength, you have your own, your purpose, you have talent, you have gift, find out what, get to know you. Some of us don't do that. We don't have relationships with ourselves. We have relationship with everybody else, and guess what happens? Sometimes those relationships become a distraction. And that happens, and some of us lose ourselves in relationships. And so even when you've gone through, like I did, the separation of divorce, that's the best time to find out who you are. Even if you have to revisit the childhood, the little girl in you, the 5, 6, 7, 8-year-old, because a lot of us have experienced trauma and we deal with arrested development. That means sometimes in our development, we didn't get the things that we needed at certain stages in our life. But you know, it's never too late to go back and heal from old wounds, from open wounds that you still battle with. Because I've seen people, women who have become successful in a lot of areas, but sometimes, because I am a, you know, counselor in theology, I can kind of look at them and go, I see the 10-year-old girl who dealt with trauma. I see the person who was abused. Because sometimes, even in the pulpit, women who speak, anger comes out. Like there's something there, like maybe unforgiveness, something that's still there. So when you take out that time to get to know you, get to find out what wounds I have open. How am I affecting other people? Because sometimes you are and you don't even know it. Okay, so that was what do I do now when I went to divorce and I went back to school and got all that together. So now I end up moving to Richmond, Virginia, which kind of disrupts a whole lot of stuff I was doing because I have finally, wait, let me back up. I did want to share, but this isn't that same season. What do I do now? I remember going on unemployment and we was really struggling again. I had my own apartment. I finally had moved into my own apartment, only one bedroom apartment, but guess what? It was my own place again. So now I'm in a season of stability, gaining back my stability. But I remember going on unemployment and months going by and rent, you know, money, is the rent is still, you know, you still got paid the rent, but my money is depleted. And I remember sitting at a computer saying, what do I do now? And what do I do next? And I remember, and I believe it was God brought back to my remembrance, because remember I went to beauty school, that I always wanted to make my own products, start my own business. And I said, I want to use what's in my hands. I said, God, you gave me something in my hands, because I believe that our talent, our skills, our gifts should sustain us for life. There should be a way that we can brand those things inside of us, that we can be able to take care of ourselves. I truly believe that. And so I sat there at my computer like, there's something I have in my hands. And he reminded me that you always wanted to make products. I was like, okay. So when that revelation came, I had hair clients and I told them, you guys are gonna be my testers. I'm gonna make some natural products. I'm a holistic person. I love all things natural, all things holistic. I'm one person who I can't stand medication unless you have to take it for life. That would be like the last result for me. I'm like, what is out there naturally that I can use to help me? So I started making my own natural products, natural, you know, butters for the body and the hair, and my lip butters, and then I started making shampoos, and then so I used my clients to test them out. And once they said, these are great, Cheryl, I was like, oh, there we go. So I utilized that skill. I was able to look back and see, wow, this is part of my purpose as a cosmetologist. The other part of the purpose was I was tired because I was working at a salon full time. I needed my money. That I did do that when I was going to unemployment, but that money fluctuates up and down because it's client based. So I'm like, I need to make some money. So the other revelation came was, why don't you go mobile? Why don't you create a mobile salon and travel to your clients? That's what I did. You learn to make, one thing about when you find out who you are during that time, you get to be creative. You know, a lot of things just come to your mind because now it's you, yourself, and you. And so you can kind of think, you can be creative, you can be imaginative. Sometimes we have to go back to that little child because we might have lost that, like I said, arrested development. And remember what it is to be imaginative. Remember we used to play? I don't even know if kids do that too much today. They play a lot of video games, but we used to play. Play outside, play pretend. Some of us need to go back to pretend stage. Let's pretend. And I had to do that. I'm like, well, I used to play house, I used to play salon, hairdresser, all that stuff. Pray like I'm preaching. I used to put on the loose sheets and thought I was Jesus and Mary. And I'm just preaching, and I got the book open. Even when I couldn't read that Bible, I was in there preaching, and Mary and Jesus. So everything, let me tell you, God is so good. Everything that I have imagined so far from a little girl has came to pass, and I was actually able to actualize those things. So you can do that. And always be intentional like this. Getting in a room with other people who have the same goal and the same purpose, who have the same desire and the same passion. And part of dismantling those disempowering thoughts is getting away from the people who perpetuate those thoughts, who constantly speak negative, people who are pessimistic. I know because I'm a person who's optimistic, it bothers my spirit when I'm around people who are very negative. And I understand that negativity may be coming from their own trauma. But when I'm trying to grow and build myself up, I don't need to be around that. So another strategy is, do not listen to your naysayers. Don't let your naysayers speak over your life. Get the ones that are yaysayers. They speak, they see you, they see into you. And they, you know, you align yourself with the right people because you don't know who the next person is going to be to get you to the next level in life. You don't know who has the answer. You don't know who has the yes. So it doesn't even matter if you don't have anything. Being in the right room with the right people, you don't know what kind of connection, what kind of collaboration. I believe it's so powerful when women can get together and build together. You know, getting away from that, Well, I gotta get mine. How about maybe we can partner together and do some things? Maybe towards a cause. You know how much of an impact we can make when we start thinking that way? So part another strategy is you gotta change the mindset. You have to think about, how can I serve? Because I believe each and every one of us are here to serve. In some capacity, no matter what it is, we are here to serve other people. You're not in a land, a country by yourself. You're here with other people. So how about becoming a positive impact? One of the things I like to do is when I meet people, I like to deposit some positive in them. So by the time I left them, they are a better person than when they met me. I believe in leaving a mark that cannot be erased. That is one of my main missions. So wrapping it up to what do I do now? Going back to when I moved to Virginia, like I said, everything taken off. I didn't want to go through that story, it would take a long time, but I had another desire to write a book. I love to write. Another talent I saw is I like to talk, as some of you probably can tell. And I love to write. And I found for me, I articulate myself better when I write. And I think it's because I'm more relaxed. I don't have distractions. I think I get distracted when people are talking and I can't think clearly. So I found, you know, that's okay, Cheryl, because for a moment I felt a little bad about that. Like a lot of times, I don't know if you ever experienced this. There's a lot of times I've been in situations I wanted to say things and I couldn't really articulate or verbalize the way I wanted to at that moment. And it's frustrating because when I leave that moment, everything comes back to me and I'm like, why couldn't I think of that while I was in the moment? Even when I was growing up in the projects and people were, you know, were confrontational and wanted to say things about me and I didn't have a voice at that time, and I would go home and just struggle and cry. And I got tired of doing that because that stuff messed with your nervous system. I'm bald for hours. I'm bent out of shape. I'm hurting. My stomach hurt because I didn't stand up for myself. But finally, when I learned to do that, you know, I became more vocal. But I realized I love to write. I can get very lengthy. So I said, you know what? It came to me again, let me write my story. Because I don't know, again, I wrote my book to serve other people, share some of the traumas, and there's a lot more in there, that I have experienced. Not only the homelessness, I went through molestation, I went through a whole lot of stuff. People getting killed in front of me. And I'm like, well, I've overcome a lot, and I'm still here. And I believe I should be on somebody's medication. But it's because of the grace of God, you know, I didn't have to go through that. But I'm so glad that as a mental health professional, I get to work with a lot of women and other people who have gone through so much. And these are the clients I have every day. They're still trying to find out who they are, why they're here. And so they have those same questions. So I say, no, but let me write a book and share my story. Let me out. Because that's what's going on now. In all of my seasons, I'm still letting a part of me out. Things that I desired, things that I dreamed. They still being actualized even till today. There's still more stuff I want to accomplish. And I know you have so many things you haven't even tapped into yet. But know that there is more. So now I'm in Virginia. I wrote my book. I got it out there. I started the natural product business, and I started the mobile salon business. But I came through another financial crisis, and I was on unemployment. I had got my master's degree, and it took me about a year before I found something in the field. You know how hard it is. So you go to school, but a lot of times they say, we need you to have at least 1 or 2 years paid experience doing this. I'm like, well, how am I gonna get my feet in the door? I got my internship I did for about a year as a social work intern. Why is that not good enough? I went to one of the best schools, Fordham University, which I never thought I would have gotten to because I didn't go back to school until I was in my 30s, going into my 40s. And so I had to cut that short. Some of my family live in Richmond, and they were saying, Cheryl, why don't you move to Richmond because the cost of living is cheaper? So I decided to do that. I got hired as a mental health professional, moved down here. But now I'm like, what do I do now? Because it seemed like I was on a launching pad when I was on the doors, where I'm meeting wonderful people all over and starting to travel now in different places and speak to different women, collaborate, network. You know, that's what life is all about. And then even in that, you find out what your purpose and passion is, because sometimes somebody else is kind of walking in something that you desire, and you're connected with that person, and you get a picture, a revelation comes like, that's what I'm supposed to be doing. That is what I'm supposed to be doing. So I'm so thankful for this wonderful, wonderful opportunity here. The few quick strategies I do want to go over, another way to find your, different ways to find your purpose and your passion. I mentioned one is taking that time to get to know who you are. Asking people around you, what do you see in me? Don't be intimidated to ask people. I believe all of us have a theme that follows us. I believe there's a theme, there's a song, there's something. For me, I'm always encouraging people. It pains me again when I see people that don't know which direction to go to. I would tap into your stuff. I would see stuff like, you know what, that's a book. That's a business. That's entrepreneurship. But you'd be surprised. People don't realize it. They don't see it in themselves. Like, oh my God, I never thought of that. I have a friend who's great at couponing and finding bargains. She wanted to start her own business. She couldn't find a job. I said, why don't you become a coupon coach? Oh my God. Yes. She have a gift of helping people find bargains and deals. Because a lot of times we're so busy, we don't do that. I have coupons in my wallet and forget I have them in there. I'm just not that disciplined with that. But I'm like, you're great at this. You can help people in so many. So I started utilizing it, like, wow, that's a gift. That's what I do every day when I do counseling. I help people kind of see their strength because everything is person-centered. So apply that person-centeredness to yourself. We do it for other people. A lot of us are good at encouraging other people. Girl, you're good at that. But when it comes to ourselves, we can't find it. We don't see it. Whatever it is that's blocking your sight from seeing that, that's the time to get into you. I got a little more time, Christen. Okay, so let me go to the little quick points I want to make sure I cover. We talked about the no naysayers, using what's in your hands, visiting that little girl in you, understanding that maybe for a season, like I said, for a season I worked in a salon, but when another season came, I decided I need to go mobile because I need to keep all of my money because I just needed to take care of some things, pay some bills. Think about the things you daydream about. This is one thing. I find myself even now, because now I'm ready to transition out of working as a mental health professional and just speaking full-time or going into full-time ministry. So I'm just waiting for the time to do that and take care of all the logistics. But I find myself at work always daydreaming about my business, my coaching business, my speaking business. So I'm on a computer doing all kinds of other things when I have the time. And I work in people's homes, so I do a lot of in-home counseling and in-home mental health counseling. But so I get to be at home a lot in between my clients. I'm constantly working on my stuff in between all of that, and that's all I daydream about. So think about the things you dream about all the time. Where do your mind goes? Some of you at work and your mind is somewhere completely different, things that you really want to do, but you really, because some of us work in places we don't even want to work at anymore, but we do what we have to do. Take an inventory, I talked about that, of your strength and what the friends and family say about you. And I think that's about it, things that you envision. I think there's so much to tap into, and I don't think, like I said, we have many facets to us, different seasons, different changes, and you find out something else about yourself. Getting in a room with the right people, maybe you discover something you didn't even know you had. You know, some of us never even thought about coming into entrepreneurship, but life circumstances kind of pushed us in that direction. So look at the themes. Like I said, the thing for me was always speaking and pouring into people's lives and doing the counseling and doing the coaching. So I said, okay, well, I started the life purpose coaching business because, I mean, that's me. I'm about purpose. I'm about living. That's what I talk about all the time. I can't help it. It follows me. So that's my theme. So kind of tap into what's your theme in your life, something that's been consistent from your childhood to now. There is something, if you take out the time, you'll be able to discover what it is. And that is all I have to say, and I hope that was encouraging to somebody.